So welcome to the vet. I'm here with Max Brandrett, who is you're the master art forger, but you've also you're the Barnardo's boy and also the circus boy. You've been known as.
Yes.
So you've had led a really interesting life. Do you want to just outline, you know, some
just a few details of my early days? Born in Buckingham Road, up near the station, in a basement flat, and it consisted of a one room, back room, a kitchen, or we called it a scullery, an outside loo with a mangle. We always had a mangle. I've got one half brother, one half sister, one half brother. And those early days were tough.
And what time was that around? The
early 50s.
Okay.
When rationing was still around. You're too young to remember rationing.
Yeah. I don't remember it, but I know that it
was the days when you'd get tally men, like they would knock on the door and you'd hide behind the couch. And I remember Mum saying to me, go to the door and tell him Mum not in. I go to the door and say, Mum said she's not in. So,
yeah.
And it was a tough life. But from that time onwards, it was homes. So I went to Barnardo's in Warren Farm, used to be an old workhouse up there. And the workhouse is gone now, but there were three cottages. And when I was doing my documentary, the cottage I was in was called Ash, and that's still there today.
Yeah.
So we did a wonderful film there, very emotional. And then it was back home to Buckingham Road, still the same. I was the only one out of all of us that had shoes on, so we couldn't go to school. My brother, I could go to school, but they couldn't. And then it got so bad, my mum was Yorkshire. Mum's saying, at the top of the steps, she'd say, don't stand out like a wet wheat, come and have a fag. So that's all the neighbours are coming down. But my mum was Yorkshire, true and true. She was fabulous. But it got, Mum had four jobs, as I say. So it got to a time when I remember one day, Mr. Odin coming down, Miss Gibson, down the steps, and he said, come on, lads. He said, we're going to take you to a place where you're going to be safe. So we went upstairs, Morris Traveller, travelled up for a place called Barkingside, and it's still there today. The Barking Homes, the village homes, Barkingside. It really, Mark, it was a village surrounded by houses named Joy, Heather, all different flowers. And I walked across the green with my brother, and Mr. Castle said, you're going to Joy, son, but your brother's going to Honeyton. I didn't realise until I got into Joy it was a cottage for wet beds, because I was wet in the beds, you see.
Yeah.
So I thought, well, their policy, if you don't wet the bed for 7 days, you go to another cottage. And I was very good, Mark, you know.
Yeah.
Mam Stanley came in, she said, keep dry for 7 days and you'll go and join your brother. I did it for 6 days. I was so excited, on the seventh day I wet the bloody bed. Sorry. So what I did, I knew the guy there, a night watchman, used to take the boys out to the loo. So what I did, this guy was dry next to me, called Dougie Banks. So I swapped the sheets over. So he got my wet ones, I had his dry ones.
Yeah.
The next morning, the matron comes in. She goes, hello, boys. 1, 2, 3, out. She comes to me. She goes, well done, Max. Well done. Brilliant. And then she goes to Dougie Banks. She goes, you dirty boy. She said, how could you, Mr. Dougie Banks? So you know what to do. So he had to whip his sheets up, go downstairs in a tin bath and wash his sheets in cold water.
Yeah.
That was it.
And but you were born in Brighton, weren't you?
Yeah, born in Buckingham Road, near the station.
Near the station. And that's changed a lot, hasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, beyond recognition almost, would you
well,
say?
Well, not Buckingham Road, I mean, yeah, but I still go up there and stand outside the basement flat with all that when I was taken away. I mean, I was nearly 12 years in Barnardo's. And then we went for so many different Barnardo homes. We went to Goldings, we went to Watson Over Training School, and we went to Barsham Rectory, where we were fostered out with Reverend Soden. Incidentally, that was historical because Nelson's mother was born there, and the five Cavaliers hid in a priest hole. So, and then I would have had a housekeeper called Mr. and Mrs. Fish. So Mr. and Fish, when we got too much for the vicar, they left, but they took us with them. We didn't know that they went and opened a shop, but how can you put my brothers in the sweet shop? There's no chance. We had no stock left. We kept nicking it all the time. Loads of it was going. So we had happy days. I love Barnardo's. I really do love Barnardo's.
Yeah.
That is why I support...
They do great work.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Mike Mendoza. Can I mention Mike Mendoza?
Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah. I did a lot for his charity, you know. We used to do the Variety Club dues, but I made quite a few shillings, but I'm a great fan of Barnardo's and that. Anyway, So Barnardo's, all those years there, am I talking too much?
No, it's fine.
That's okay.
Yeah.
All those years in Barnardo's, I suddenly thought, Mum wanted to take us home. Mum was living in with this not such a nice fella. So I spent exactly 6 weeks with him, and he beat me up once. So I thought, drunken stepdad sort of image. I ran away on a cold November night, Brighton Station, went to London. Can I say another crime I've got to confess to?
Yeah.
I screwed some of the gas meters in the guest house just for survival, right?
Yes.
You can edit that out if you like.
That's all right.
And I did them all while they were at breakfast, so, right? And I went back with a pocket full of sixpences.
Yeah.
And I thought, the only job I can get now is either live in a hotel or a circus. So I decided that, I think, hello, men wanted for circus, King's Ride, Chipping Norton. So I took a train to Chipping Norton, walked down the lane. I looked about 10. I was so skinny, I looked like a little baby. And Louis, the ring groom, said to me, how old are you? I said, I'm 10. I mean, I'm 15. He went, I've got no jobs, you. This is heavy work, lifting down and, you know. I said, I can do it. And he went, I walked away. I went, OK, thank you. He said, come on. He said, come with me. So have you ever worked with elephants? And I went, no, I've never seen one. Took me into this massive elephant tent with 12 elephants, right, all lined up, all chained up. I'll give you the names, never forget them. Leela, Mary, Kamala, Susie, Dala, Dana, Rani, Sita, May, Mabel, Jadie and Sally. I looked after those elephants for nearly 3 years, but also I was a sign writer and artist. I used to do all the edits.
The circus.
Yeah, I used to do all the clowns' faces, and I became almost one of the family. But as I said, I want to cut it short a little bit. I'd had 3 years on the circus, became one of the family. I thought, I've had enough. So I'm going to go to London.
Yeah.
With my little savings, took a flat in Cricklewood, and thought, what shall I do? I know, I play guitar, I can sing a little bit. I'll do some of my paintings. You could buy canvases in the 60s for about £1 each, you know, old ones. Rub them down, right, and then prime them and put a new picture. And I was doing pictures of Nelson, shipping scenes, primitives, naive, the lot. So I used to go to Port Ellen Road, put them against the railings on a blanket, take my guitar out, start singing my songs. But I only knew 2 songs. So what I did, I kept moving all the time. So that I remember one guy said to me, oi, mate, he said, you sing the same songs all the time. I said, I know. I said, but you'd never put any money in. So on your bike. So that was it. And then...
But have you always had that talent for art then? Because we can see some of the...
Yeah,
Jack Vetriano.
Yeah, these are Vetrianis, yeah.
Yeah.
These, I don't do these for the gallery because obviously he's still around, but I've been doing these for quite some time, you know. And but in the room with the view, I do a whole mixture.
Which is in Worthing, that's
it? Yeah, it's in Worthing.
I gallery do, where you
yeah,
you've
I got exhibit now, yeah.
Exhibit there.
Yeah, and I do quite a few. I'm not keen on Lowry's, I'm not keen on Picasso's because I love challenges. I love the old masters. And there's an artist called Coolidge. I don't know if you know.
Yeah.
You ever seen when they're playing poker, dogs playing poker?
Yes.
Well, I've got those on show. And I love doing them because there's a lot of detail, you know.
Yes.
So that's it. Yeah.
So that was in the 60s. So did you find that there's a market for kind of this kind of artwork?
What those?
Yeah, or any kind of, you know.
I couldn't sell my own, Mark.
Right.
Couldn't. So that's why... became a forger.
Yes.
And that's why I got nicked for it.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, I thought, well, you know, I couldn't be a folk singer, so I only knew 2 songs, so it's a problem, wasn't it, really?
Yeah.
But let me just tell you the most eventful day of my life, right, in Portobello Road in 1967. I just sang my 2 songs, and it was quite busy, you know, and this young guy walks down in a really nice suit. You could tell this was Savile Row. This wasn't Sammy Gordon's, you know, which is a cheap tailor.
Yeah.
And he went, this is what he went, hello, John. He said, do you do smudges, like from photographs? I went, what? I said, do you do smudges? Smudges is a nickname for a painting.
Yes.
Do you do smudges from photographs? I went, I think so. And he went, can you hold on a minute then? I went, OK. So he ran up the road, came back with his photographs. He said... And he showed me, and there was like of a woman about 50.
I said,
can you do that? I said, yeah. So I said, I'll do it next week. So I went back to my Cricklewood's little garret flat, and I did the picture. Next week I came down, and I was standing there about midday. He came down. He went, did you do the smudge, son? I went, yes. I said, my friends are up the road there. And I went, oh, okay. So I walked behind him, and it was, I think it was the Duke of Lonsdale's pub. And we walked in to a side pub, and it was very dark. And I thought, it's empty. No, it wasn't. Ronnie Kray was sitting.
We'll just leave it there for now. We can talk about this in the second half. So join us for the second half, where I'll be talking to Max a lot more about his wonderful life. So join us for the second half, where we'll be talking to Max. Max Brandrett, the master art forger.
Yes.
We've just talked about '60s and when you met the Krays. So
yes, as I said, when I'd finished this smudge, as we say, and walked up the road with who I found out was Ronnie Kray's boyfriend, we went to a pub, I think it was the Duke of Lonsdale, and instead of going to the main bar, I went to a side bar, and I walked in, I thought it was quite dark. No, it wasn't. Ronnie Kray was sitting down and Reggie was at the bar. Frankie Fraser was in the corner. And as immediately I knew who they were. And I didn't freeze, I just stood there. And Ronnie stood up and he walked towards me and said, "You got the smudge then, son?" I went, "Yes." He said, I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Don't call me sir, all right? Don't call me sir." I went, "Okay," I tried not to. He said, "Show me." So he said, "Where is it?" I pulled it out of the bag and it went all quiet. And I thought, God, he doesn't like it. And he goes, "Reggie, have a look at this, Reggie. Reggie, this is bloody proper, mate. This is proper." He said, "You did this?" I went, "I did." He said, "It's mum's eyes, isn't it? It's mum's eyes. He's got it." And Reggie comes over and said, "Yeah," he said, "that's, you did that?" I went, "I did." So he said, "Have a drink." So I had a shandy. And I sat, no word of a lie, Mark, I sat between Ronnie Kray that side, Reggie there. I was in the middle. And then the boy, Frankie Fraser was on the other side. The boyfriend was standing up. And they were talking about me. And he said, "Love it." He said, "I love the smudge, son. How much are you then?" I went, and I was going, and he went, Reggie says, "Give him a two." I thought, £2? No, it was £200. £200 in 1967 was like giving you 1,000.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it. I couldn't get out quick enough, honestly. And I walked out.
And did they commission art again?
No,
from you,
I never saw
was
them.
That the only time?
He invited me to Valence Road to meet his mum, but I declined the offer on that when I said I had a cold, so I couldn't go.
Yeah.
And,
And did that led you to kind of produce more art, didn't it, then?
Because then I became a forger.
Yeah.
And then I met the great Tom Keating and then say no more, the master art forger. He was the business. You know, I'll tell you a reason why we got away with it so long in the auction rooms. The auction rooms couldn't work out. Do you know when you get a painting that's very old, it starts to crack, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's called cracking or patina or whatever it is. So Tom found a way of making the cracks. And what it is, you're probably too young to remember woodwork at school. It was called bead glue or scotch glue, right?
Right.
And this is like a dry glue. It's like, looks like lentils. You buy a pound in it you get a great big tub of it for that. Place it in a pot, overnight, cold water, it goes to a jelly. Next morning, you take your old picture, right?
Yeah.
And it goes to a glue light. You brush it over, right? Take it to a heater, not a dry heater, electric heater. Keep circling it like that, and it starts to crack. You'll actually hear it cracking. And then Tom used to say, "Yeah, a bit more in the sky there, son." And so he used to do that.
Yeah.
And then you take it to the tap, you wash off the bead glue because it's water-based, you get your Hoover out with a dust bag, you dust it all over, wipe the surface off, it's full of dirt, all the cracks are full of black. White polish on top of that, glass on top of that, old nails from the garden on top of that, in the auctions. And then go down to the auction and say, "Hello, John, would you have a look up these smudges?" That's how we used to do it.
Yeah, and there was a big market for that. I mean, what's the, is there a lot of art forgers around nowadays? Or
yeah, some very good ones.
Is it becoming harder to kind of get?
Well, I don't think there's any art forgers. I think because if you're forging, you know, it's a dangerous game, as I proved it. Three stretches in Nick's, it's not a good idea, is it?
Yeah.
So I'm a legit artist doing copies. I'm a copyist.
Yes.
I used to be a forger. I mean, known for a forger, you know?
Yeah. And what artists do you... we've got Jack Vetriano here, but what other artists do you try and copy?
Coolidge, Caravaggio, the Ertes, Feinekers, Louis Waynes, you name it, I've painted it. Whatever you put in front of me, I'll copy.
Yeah.
Do you know what? I can remember when I was in court years ago, and the judge, I was in the dock, and he went, "Mr. Brandrett, you're a very accomplished artist, but tell me, why do you persist in doing these fakes?" I went, "Sir, it's like I see an old canvas, I get withdrawal symptoms, so I've got to put a fake on it." That's it.
Did you do him a painting?
I could have done, couldn't I?
The drawing.
Yeah. But yeah. It's been, do you know what I'm going to say, Mark? It's been absolutely fantastic this last 2 years. I've really enjoyed it.
Yeah. And you've now got a gallery, haven't you? So that's
important. Yeah, I've got a gallery to go to.
Yeah.
I mean, you think, 2 years ago, I was teaching on stage called a company called Entertainment Direct, where you've got lovely, beautiful, lovely old ladies in their 80s and 90s. The thing is, before he got there with his big lectures in, they used to go to sleep on me. I think, oh, no. They said the first seven rows would sleep. So they, you know.
Yeah.
But I did love teaching them, you know.
How long would... How long do you spend on painting?
I think about 3 or 4 days doing the Vitriani. The big pictures, like the old masters, a lot longer, you know, but I'd say paint, you know, maybe a week, 2 weeks on them. The Coolidges I really love doing. I mean, if you know his art, it's Victorian, plain poker. I just love the detail in it.
Yes.
So, but, you know, I'm not keen on the Lowry's too much. I'm not keen on Picasso's. Because I'm going to be honest, I don't find them challenging enough, you know.
Yeah. And have you ever been in direct contact with some of the artists that you copy?
Only him to get his signature right.
Right.
Sorry about that. Yeah. Well, sorry about that.
And you come back to Brighton quite often, don't you?
So it's
changed.
I love the lanes. I love the lanes. Don't forget, I got nicked and just down the road here a few 2 years ago, especially Edward Street, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. These paintings here, I mean, these are just for your own...
No, they're for you see, you can't put these in the gallery, Mark, because there is, you know, still around.
Yes.
So that would be copyright. But I always change it slightly, like I put a glass in there, so it's not an actual copy. It's not a bad copy, that, I must admit. If you looked at the original, that's not far off it, you know. But, I don't do this so much now, because these for a private a person who bought these, you know. But I'm happy with what I'm doing now. I love it.
Yeah, and for I know there's quite a few people that do copy art, as we've said. I mean, what do you think they're as good as the work that you've produced, or?
No, I mean, you know, you've got a couple of Brighton artists that are pretty good. You know, I mean, they're excellent at what they do. We all do our different things. I don't have any problem, you know. They do their thing, I do mine. I mean, you know, there's guys doing them all over, you know, but you can't get them through the rooms anymore. You know, in my day you could, because they've got all x-rays and, you know, if you've seen that programme, Fake or Fortune, right, you couldn't get one of those through on new canvas, you know. We did. Tom Keating was one of the best in the business, and I studied under him. You know, as you know, I get a Christmas card from the Ford Squad every year. Wish you were here, Max. Bless you.
Yeah, exactly. So it was much easier, was it, in the 60s and 70s? I mean, standard.
Oh, absolutely.
Reason. Yeah, I mean, what was some of the... There's probably quite a few fakes going around that you were involved in then that on people's walls.
Yeah, quite a few, actually.
What, are they obviously...
Well, you don't know, do they? Yeah, I can, yeah. I went to a house and this for having dinner, and I thought, hello, it's one of mine on the wall there. You know, I can't remember. Oh, I think I did a quite nice shipping scene, you know, shipping off Dover, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And it was definitely one of mine, and it was one I did when I was with Tom Keating, because of the ageing process, and I know my pictures as well. But
that's key, isn't it, to art forgery? Old
canvas, but... Yeah. You know, the auction rooms were not too clever with that bead glue. I mean, we did... we did fool them a bit, you know.
Is it still the same process that people use now to kind of try and age the canvas?
I think you could do it. I mean, yeah, I think you could go into an auction room. I mean, in my day, Tom Keating and I used to go in as father and son, like leather jackets, polo neck jumpers, and then go to the auction rooms. I'm not going to mention which one because I'm barred from a few. And they would go in, so, hello, sir, got a couple of smudges in the car, so do you have a look? So what we used to do, we used to put a painting there, two goodies and a lot of pot boilers, what we call pot boilers. And the auctioneer would be going with their authority, yes, nice, nice, yes. And then he'd come to the goodie and he'd go, oh, yes, that's quite interesting. And I did a lovely painting of shipping off Dover, right? And he went, oh, yes, that's interesting. I said, can you tell me about it, sir? He said, yeah, it's probably Norwich School. Was it painted in Norwich, sir? He went, no, it's Norwich School. You know, And then what we used to do, go to the auction rooms, naughty, and sort of like, you know, watch the bidding go up on it.
Yeah.
But that was years ago, Mark, years ago. I don't do it now.
And plans for the future, you've got this, your work exhibited at the gallery, so it's kind of changed quite a bit now. That's in Worthing. Where can we find that?
That's in Warwick Street.
Warwick Street, okay.
In Worthing. And also, I've got a book deal. And also, the other thing is, I'm happy with what I'm doing.
Yeah.
No more forgeries, I promise, God.
Perfect. That's a perfect way to end it. Max, thanks for coming in today.
All my pleasure.
And, see you soon.
Yeah.
Cheers. Goodbye.